Music. It's the love of music that brings us together. The love of music that forms the bond between us. For the next hour, join us for the love of music, presenting those aspects of music which excite, provoke, and inspire. Our host today is David Dubal, WNCN Music Director, pianist, educator, and writer on music. Here is David Dubal for the love of music.
This is David Dubal, and this is the second program where I am honored to have as my guest Tamás Vásáry. How are you today?
Very fine, David.
Great. Now, last time we talked about your dreams, we talked about Dohnányi, we talked of your early experiences as a child prodigy, we talked a little bit about Liszt. Now, today I'd like to talk a little bit about, and it's going to be an all Chopin program, so we'll say some words on Chopin, the poet of the piano, and we will talk about some of the pianists that have perhaps influenced you. I know you wrote an article on Annie Fischer, Hungarian-born pianist, I think, studied with Dohnányi, didn't she?
Yes, she studied with Dohnányi.
Well, she's been a force in your life, and I know she's coming to America for the first time in a long time in September, am I right?
Yes, I think she was not in the States in the last 10 years, mm-hmm. and only once before she made a long tour, and she made her New York debut with George Sale, as I remember.
And tell me about this woman who is really just an extraordinary pianist. And I know a few years ago you said to me that she taught you so much about Mozart in a way.
Well, I would say very simply, she's for me the greatest pianist I ever heard.
Really?
And then everybody is thinking, oh, greatest pianist, it means playing faster, mm-hmm, stronger, mm-hmm. And clearer than anybody. It's nothing of that kind because she sometimes makes mistakes and doesn't care. But the real spiritual experience, what music means, that is there. So that when you become a musician, or either professional or just a music lover, because music evokes in you something which nothing else could do. Or if something else could do, it is formulated in music in such a way that it is really, you feel that it is the spiritual manifestation of something essential in your life, emotional, and something which is showing us in a way our future, let's say. The music and art at all, but music more than anything, is for me a signpost. Mm-hmm. A signpost showing that we are spirits. And we have body as well. But what is most important in ourselves, the spiritual quality. And this spiritual quality wants to live more and more. And if you make a difference between the caveman and between a Mozart, as the best of us, let's say, you will see the difference that one is more spiritual than the other. Mm-hmm. And that can show us our way from the caveman to Mozart. Mm-hmm. And we mix the two together by our daily experience. But I mean,
we do mix the two together, and it's an interesting thought, because music itself, especially abstract music, a deep symbolic language of the nervous system almost, and into the soul it can creep. And yet some of the creepiest spirits in the history of the world, monsters such as Hitler, loved music with a passion. How does this work? I mean, how does a man who loves music, how can he become a monster, you see?
Well, you see, that's I don't know if you have seen the theater piece, Amadeus.
Yes.
I have seen it in London, and I know that it's played also in the States, in New York. And that is exactly this question. How is it possible? Because, of course, it's a bit of caricature of Mozart, who you see through the eyes, the jealous eyes of Salieri. Therefore, I love the piece, because for me, this caricature is not a caricature. It is how a jealous person sees somebody augmenting all the weaknesses in the object of his jealousy. So it's a very natural thing. And that shows that indeed all those, when we say, how is it possible that a Mozart would behave this or that way? How is it possible on the other end of the spectrum, Hitler was able to enjoy beautiful music? Now, this is it, exactly, that we all have everything in ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And we are that we are trying to do the best of all that thing, which is as a hologram in ourselves. Because if you want to be very mystical, of course, there is a old saying that in what is above, it's under. So what in the small, there is the whole universe. In one cell, there is the whole universe.
Yes.
So we possess all these qualities, which is good and evil and everything in between. And of course, then comes the unique individual, mm-hmm. which makes the whole a whole lot worthwhile, because that's the interesting thing about creation. Why is this fish different than the other? Not exactly, not only the survival, because all these fantastic patterns and a fish skin, you see, it's not always a purpose of survival, but all this individuality, this is a unique manifestation of something which want to get a new consciousness. And I believe in very much that we are on a very, very important point in the whole universe in being human beings, where we have this spirituality, we acquire the consciousness, which we don't know in any other living beings. And we also shouldn't consider that this consciousness of ours, it is the last word.
Yes.
It might be a turning point, but a turning point to a higher something, and we can peep in the hole through the keyhole of art, for instance.
Yes.
Because when you listen to the Così fan tutte, the farewell quintet, then suddenly you feel something, oh yes, there is a direction, and to go to this direction, that is worthwhile. Because as we said, caveman, and we said Mozart. The caveman also had joys and suffering. Mozart also had joys and suffering. But what can we gain by going towards Mozart direction? More happiness, mm-hmm. more elated, more higher state of consciousness.
Yes.
This is the famous word which Eastern mysticists are using, and I am believing very much that, for instance, in our Western society, somebody who can really, truly enjoy music is in the moment of enjoying music in a higher state of consciousness. Now, if we can imagine a human being 1 million year later or some thousand years later who can be in that state all the time, it's a fantastic thing.
Mm-hmm.
And why not?
And
why not? And so therefore I think art is so important, because it shows us this way. And now when you see a case when in a Mozart was not able to maintain through his whole life this incredible intensity of this higher state of consciousness, it's more than natural.
Yes.
Because if he could only to have this during the time that he composed only,
yes.
It is such an incredible amount and such an incredible quality and quantity that if in the rest of his time he was more human and he was more relaxed and even vulgar, it's more than natural. Because I don't know if you experienced that, David, but I'm experiencing on myself, and I have, for instance, a great stress and a tremendous concentrated work. Then afterwards, I like to make puns. I like to joke. I like even to see a vulgar television. Say, so
absolutely.
Just to relax. And if you consider what is this when you go to see the young people to dance, rock, and all these things. And it's like nearly as an animal behavior. But it's a very natural art outlet after this drill which they get at university and in high school, what is our education is giving today to the young people. They must relax. And so this is it. So a Mozart is not one thing, but it's also a composition. And if he had so much on one side, it's natural he has a bit of that. And if we have, on the other side, you have a Hitler who is such a horror in his whole life, certainly there is also in him something which needs the other side. And that's when he is listening to music.
So interesting your answer is. And people have said, oh, Mozart, the poor man, or Schubert, they died so early, Mozart at 35 and Schubert at 31. And I say, ah, but those 35 years, that man had ecstasy, moments of ecstasy that are beyond what mortal man usually has. And the play Amadeus is really, to me, a great sense of awareness builder, because people say human nature and it cannot change. But of course, it's always in flux. You said that maybe we're only in a point of, at a certain moment, we're going to expand into a new consciousness. The fact that this play is discussing something as insidious as envy and jealousy through the eyes of the mediocre, it is a beautiful play on that level alone.
That's incredible.
We're going to actually begin our musical part of the program, Tamás, and we're going to have an all Chopin program. We're going to begin with a Grand Valse Brillante. How did it manifest itself in a Chopin who was in many ways a common man, to be able to, in fact, he was a petty man in some ways, to manifest in this waltz the spirit of the ballroom, so, or in the ballades, the spirit of a narrative, of something that touches all humanity, or in the etudes. It's a mystery.
If I could tell you in words, then I would be as good poet as Chopin was a composer. Basically, what I think it's, for me, which is the most touching, this tremendous elegance, this sort of beautiful elegance, you know, which is not elegance in just wearing a dress, but wearing a human being.
Yes.
This is as the grand seigneur who he was. And also the noble elegance of a Polish peasant.
Yes.
Because if you have ever seen a real beautiful folk dance of Polish people or Hungarian people or any folk dancers, you will see the inborn best of somebody, mm-hmm. this natural grace, and that is coming through Chopin waltzes and dance music, as mazurkas and polonaises,
yes.
as well. And for me, therefore, is in the interpretation the most important is this noble aristocracy, which I mean in the best sense of the word.
Yes.
He put in the music, and therefore I don't like when it's stamping too much and taking too much the virtuoso side, which is of course there, because it's sometimes difficult to play. But for me, the touching element in the Chopin work is this grand seigneur,
mm-hmm.
who he opens the ball. For instance, the last movement of the F minor concerto or the E minor concerto. And I even have this vision to see a ballroom with this beautiful, noble young people who are dancing and flirting,
yeah.
and all the beauty of this jeunesse, this youth who goes through the most beautiful days of his life, probably. And certainly most beautiful days of his life, because after he will always remember of this, and by the remembers that becomes so beautiful by
yes.
the souvenir.
He enshrined his youth and all that he loved in Poland in his music after he left, after 20 years old.
Yes, and that's this nostalgic element which makes it so beautiful, because what is interesting that in real life we are practically unable to grasp what it is. And through our memories, we are able to become the poet of the past.
Yes.
So in the present, we cannot be poet. We are too down to earth. But thinking back to the past, we can't become poets. And also we can become poets thinking of the future. Of course, we would be happier if mm-hmm. we could be as poet in the present.
Mm-hmm.
And then that would be the highest state
oh,
of consciousness.
Oh, how wonderful, Tamás. And we become, in a wonderful process, poets in the present when we're listening to art.
Absolutely.
To listening to what we will now listen to, which is your performance of the Grand Valse Brillante of Frédéric Chopin, Opus 34, number 1. You have just heard the art of Tamás Vásáry, and he played the Chopin waltz in A-flat. We're going to come right back after these messages and talk more with Vásáry. Tamás Vásáry is my guest. We're going to have an all Chopin program today. We're going to hear very shortly, after a word or two on the etudes, two of the etudes, the Winter Wind and the so-called Ocean, the arpeggio one. Are the etudes, they're almost like the folklore of the piano literature, are they as difficult as they say they are?
Even more. I really think these pieces are the most difficult piano pieces ever written, because they combine technically the greatest task and also to play it in such a way as is possible that one should forget about the technique and forget about the piano as an instrument, but just to hear the poem, which all the studies are. And if you want to hear what I think is the most greatest difficulty about them, that they use one type of movement, and during the whole thing is going on, like for instance the chromatic study number two, or these studies I'm playing the last
now,
two.
Yeah.
The difficulty is that the muscles are doing the same thing for a long time, you see.
Yeah.
That is not, because sometimes in these studies or even the Rachmaninoff concerto, the pattern is changing, you see. So you can relax a certain group of muscles, mm-hmm. or by doing something else. But here, no. Here, during the whole time, you are making more and more tired the same muscles.
It never stops. The yeah. technical procedure is, even though they're short pieces, basically, the technical procedure is so vastly difficult
yes.
on the
yes.
muscles.
Yes.
Yeah.
And in the same time, very transparent. The writing is so transparent, which makes so beautiful exactly the Chopin writings, in a way more beautiful even than Beethoven's or Brahms,
yes.
because the texture is so like with Mozart, you know, it's so transparent. And but this transparent, you must pay very dear for this transparency as a performer, because it reveals all the mistakes, you see, and
yeah.
therefore it's very, very tricky to play Mozart and Chopin. I think there is a similarity between the two composers, and the difficulty in both is that everything can be heard,
yes.
the slightest imperfection.
It's so interesting that Leopold Godowsky made transcriptions of the etudes, which are supposed to be the most difficult things in the world, so to speak, and yet, in a way, the original Chopin studies are more difficult, because you can fake in the Godowsky in a way. You can
yeah.
you can have this relaxation, but not in the original Chopin etudes.
No.
We're going to hear number 11 and 12, The Winter Wind and the Ocean, and you don't have to exert any pressure this moment, because you're going to be listening to your own Deutsche Grammophon recording of them. So don't worry about mistakes or anything. They're perfect. Here is the Opus 25, number 11 and 12. They're titans of the piano literature. These pieces are unreal. Tamás Vásáry, the artist. You have heard the A minor and the C minor etudes, opus 25, number 11 and 12. The pianist, my guest today, Tamás Vásáry, and we will be right back after these messages. Tamás, Chopin wrote four impromptus. The fourth, of course, is world famous because of the middle section. The first is not played that much compared to it used to be. The third is almost unknown, and the second, I think, is the masterpiece of the set. It's the F sharp major. It's almost like a ballade.
Yeah, absolutely.
It? Yeah.
It's very interesting. You are the first person tells me, and I always thought in terms of a ballade of this impromptu, when it comes this heroic thing, like a vision. It's beautiful with Chopin to have these visions, like in the F minor fantasy. He was not a soldier. He could never afford physically to go in war. Fortunately, he never went. But he was in his soul a man with ideas for which he fought in his works, and a great hero. And this great hero, carrying a flag, you know, with his hand. This is it in his works, more than in let's say in Liszt's works, who was a hero of his time as
yes.
a person. But Chopin was not, as you said. He was rather a petit bourgeois in many sense, but in his works it's the great hero who takes humanity with him in the war of purification, yes. Whatever you want to use banal words.
You know, when he is writing that Polonaise, you know that in his, as you were talking about, the mind makes you the poet of the past. He himself was the past Poland's greatness in the A flat Polonaise. He was on that horse.
And this dream quality, this hallucination, dream, and fever, you know, being a sick man, everything is distilled, everything is sublimated in his music, what he was as a person going through death and illness and fever and patriotism and everything, like in a dream, in a hallucination, it comes to him. And in, for instance, in this impromptu, after this meditative first part, slow part, comes suddenly this this march from nowhere, you know, just like a hallucination, and as in the F minor fantasy and many other pieces, and also the B minor sonata, last movement is it's like a hypnotic state which he evokes,
this dreamlike state which finally ended in the Polonaise fantasy, which Liszt actually at that time, it was so far out, he called it pathological art. Yeah. it was not real to him any longer.
And it's interesting if you notice that when Chopin is writing this heroic fights and this great movement, then he is gasping, you see.
Yeah.
This is there. B minor, or the G minor ballad.
It is a life and death struggle.
Yes, because, and he had also a bad chest, you know. Yeah. So he had, when he was very agitated, he was gasping.
And you know, what
is
you
it the right word I'm using?
It's a perfect word for it, because that certainly is the most gasping moment of that, in maybe in all of his music, the B flat minor sonata there. But it's all over. And you say, in a way, you said the destiny of the man. The destiny of the man may well have been as an artist to have this tuberculosis, because, in a certain way, the states that consumption brought on were so conducive to his mentality as an artist.
Yes, and of course, lots of people in his time had tuberculosis, but having behind that Chopin's soul, that had a significance of a kind.
The TB, his soul, and the romanticism of his day, his love for the clarity of Mozart, his love for Bach, and his exclusivity, even his love only for the piano, were also essential, I think, to that kind of personality which demanded the most fastidious environment and who demanded of the people around him almost impossibilities.
Yes.
Such an interesting man. And yet, as we said, so many flaws too. He was not of the magnitude of Liszt, who in a way he envied his strength and his virility.
Yes, but it is interesting that for me, Chopin's music is more virile than Liszt. If you consider this, the ballads.
Is it because perhaps it's greater?
No, because the virility which is in his soul, it's sublimated in the music and didn't carry it out from him through the daily life.
Yes. And Liszt, of course, had a daily life which sometimes mingled grandiloquence and theatricality which came into his art.
And this is, you know, David, which I'm very sure that everybody of today artists have this problem, that the daily life is sometimes so much in contradiction with what we should do. Mm-hmm. So the artistry which would demand peace, quietness, and even going away from society and living in the forest or having inner relaxation, and this sort of more pensive life and contemplative life, what we are doing, this is which I think causes a problem, because the daily life of today artists is just the opposite of this. And the more you are recognized, the more you are prone of leading a life which is in contradiction with which you should do.
Yes, you have always obviously felt this dissonance, because the more active you get, you also need to have that, as you said in the first program, you must walk alone for an hour. You have even gone to look at the Himalayas.
But, you know, on the other hand, this is which makes me thankful or grateful for those difficulties in my life, which I would say it was difficult For instance, when I left Hungary for 4 years, I hardly had any concerts and I had very great financial difficulties. But during these 4 years that I established my repertoire, the main body of my repertoire, so sometimes those, hard moments when you don't have the success which you would wish to have, these are the most valuable moments in your life.
I understand. We're going to hear this magnificent work, the second impromptu of Chopin, of which is really not as known as one would think, even though it's a Chopin work. It's an F sharp major, and it was composed around 1837. And we will now listen to my guest today, Tamás Vásáry, in the second impromptu of Chopin. You have heard the great pianist Tamás Vásáry in the second impromptu of Frédéric Chopin, and we will have a few messages and be back with some words, and then we will hear the second ballade of Chopin. This is David Dubal, and today my guest, the Hungarian pianist Tamás Vásáry. Do you miss Hungary?
Well, not really. From the point of view that I go back in very regularly.
Is it true that everyone in Hungary is a pianist, a born pianist at least?
No, I don't think so. But certainly there is a generation now who produces an enormous lot. And just recently I met Annie Fischer, who said she just in the last two weeks she discovered a 16 years old girl who is according to her appreciation is her successor.
Really?
Which is a great thing.
How wonderful. We're going to listen to the second ballade in F major, as the second impromptu is not known. Certainly all the ballades are well known, but this is the one least played, I believe, worldwide.
Yes.
Not that in any way it's lesser quality. How come do you think that this one is not as much played?
I think because in that one you don't have a tune which you can whistle so easily than the other one, which I don't want to say that a work which becomes popular because of the tune, it is less valuable. It has a tremendous value if a work can become popular. It must have something. But if a work doesn't become popular, it doesn't mean that it has not something which is maybe too subtle and less approachable for the first moment to the public.
Yeah.
This is the only answer that if you think, for instance, that tune, or the first ballad, or the last ballad, the tune, That's a tune which sticks in your ears and you can whistle immediately. Or this is also easier, but this is a more contemplative work.
Yes.
It's a horizontal work for me. It is a it gives the impression of being at on the sea or in a plane, and this sort of tremendous quietness where you get what's the English expression, you get in term with the world, when you get in level with everything. There is no problem, and it is just the plain beauty of the beauty, you know. That's it.
I get it. I know.
And so it's therefore it's, of course there is a very dramatic middle section of the work, but maybe because it doesn't have this sort of whistling tune element in it, you
it's probably true. I've always wondered why this work, which is so wonderful, has not gotten the same, well, the A flat ballade we heard on the first program that we did together, and some of the other pieces are more popular. Let's listen now to your performance.
I would add something.
Yes.
That is, for instance, if you consider which are the more popular Beethoven symphonies, the dramatic ones more than the pastoral ones. And this is a pastoral. The rhythm is a pastoral ballad,
the
F major ballad. And why? Because if you go to the theater, you want to what we can actually see in a theater and what is drama. this is for something which is dramatic. Not something which is, when your problems are resolved, this is, you must experience it, but you cannot talk about
that's
it.
That's right. Ah, okay. We will. That's wonderfully said before we enter this vocabulary, and I call Chopin's music a vocabulary of feeling of every shade. The second ballade in F major from your recording of the four ballades, and the artist, Tamás Vásáry. I've so enjoyed having you here for these two programs. Before we leave, I would like to know what your current projects are, if you're going to record all of the Mozart Concerti, for instance, or whatever.
So I am doing, first of all, for Deutsche Grammophon, a big project, Brahms project, because they have a big issue, all the Brahms work written, or everything, orchestra, choral, songs, and chamber works. And I am taking part in that edition, which will contain at least 100 recordings or more.
Really?
And I will do 7 or 8 in it. It depends how they can divide the quartets, because I'm doing all the trios, the quartets, with the members of the Berlin Philharmonic, and I'm doing all the variations, and the Opus 76 Capriccios and Intermezzi.
Exciting.
And so this is actually, it will come out, but actually I have recorded them already. And the other thing is, I am working for a new firm, which calls Academy.
Academy?
And yes. That was actually the Argo.
Yes.
The Argo who recorded with, who launched indeed St. Martin's on the Field. And then the director of Argo is now doing this, who was the director, because, you know, Argo became part of Decca, and Decca became part of of Deutsche Grammophon, and so, and now who, the man who built the Argo is doing this Academy recording, and they are still recording a lot with the Academy on St. Martin's. And I am, they asked me whether I want to do with the London Philharmony all the Mozart concertos for them. And
conducting,
I
said, and the
and
piano, con-
conducting and playing. And it's very handy for me. I am living in London and I can do it.
Wonderful.
That it's a nice thing, a nice pleasure. And I do also for them some solo recordings as well.
Wonderful. So you are busy, to say the least. And if I could grant you those 64 hours a day you need, I would.
Well, I would be very grateful. But anyway, it was a lovely thing to talk to you.
Tamás Vásáry, thank you for coming to WNCN and talking with me.
Thanks.
This is David Dubal, and thank you for listening.
For the love of music, with today's host, David Dubal, WNCN Music Director. We hope you'll be with us when once again we meet to listen and exchange ideas. All for the love of music. For the Love of Music is produced by WNCN New York, GAF Broadcasting Company. Thank you.